the sacred liturgies above all the worship of the Divine Majesty, it likewise contains abundant instruction for the faithful. For in the liturgy, God is speaking to His people, Christ is still proclaiming His gospel, and the people are replying to both by song and prayer. So important is the first sentence, no? As you know, it's quoting SC 33. It tells us that primarily, principally, liturgy is worship of God. Worship of the Divine Majesty. But it does something secondary. What is that? That it also informs. It forms and transforms. It has an instructive, formative, transformative dimension also to it, not in terms of its educative nature. And then it continues, for in the liturgy God is speaking to His people, Christ is still proclaiming His gospel, and the people are replying to both by song and prayer. May gusto mo akong ipalinaw dyan. Okay, where lies the informative, formative, and transformative effect of the liturgy? Not in terms of within the liturgy, we intentionally, we consciously teach a doctrine. Could be sacramental doctrine, it could be the doctrine of a particular feast or season. But it's not referring to that. What it's referring to is that by the very nature of liturgy as worship and therefore a celebration in rites and prayers, then it forms and transforms. So by the sheer experience that it gives us, that it brings us into, it's a celebration of our faith. It does that. So, God speaks to His people. That experience of hearing God speaking to us, Christ proclaiming His gospel, and we replying both by song and prayer, already it informs, forms, and transforms. And then it continues, the same passage. Faith is needed to actively participate in the liturgy. But faith in turn is nourished and deepened in liturgical celebrations. The article then turned to the interplay between faith and liturgy. They serve each other. For an actively participated liturgy, there is need for faith. I hope you are able to contextualize our ministry here as catechists, religious educators, and so on, formators of religious educators, formators of catechists. Faith is needed to actively participate in the liturgy, but in turn, faith is nourished and deepened in liturgical celebrations. I hope you notice that interplay. Therefore, when catechists draw on the Eucharistic prayers, the text of the sacramental rites, and prayers from the liturgy of the hours, they are sharing in the priestly office of Jesus Christ. Very clearly, the NNCPP is indicating a particular way of teaching liturgy. It is not by way of, although they are important, the catechism of the Catholic Church, not immediately running to the CLC, but immediately running to the great books of Father Karl Rahner on the Eucharist, no, and of the other great theologians, even of Father Ansgar Chipungo. But what is our first recourse when we teach liturgy? The sacraments or the feasts and seasons of the Church? The rites themselves. The text of the sacramental rites. The prayers from the liturgy of the hours, etc., etc. Catechesis then, according to 102, is intrinsically linked to the whole of liturgical and sacramental activity, for it is in the sacrament, especially in the liturgy, in the Eucharist, that Christ works in fullness for the transformation of human beings. So, yung experience mismo, no? Yung pagdiriwang mismo, na pinapasukan natin, na ginagawa natin, it is that which transforms us into what Christ wants us to become. And so the focus here, my dear brothers and sisters, is primarily on the liturgy as a major source about catechesis rather than liturgical catechesis, which specifically prepares for celebrating the sacraments. If you weren't somehow expecting me to speak about the second idea, liturgical catechesis, which specifically prepares for celebrating the sacraments, don't worry, I will not disappoint you. I'll be mentioning something about that. But primarily, I think the first in our agenda has to be the first one. What understanding of the liturgy should somebody who's engaged in the teaching ministry of the church have in order to do justice to what the liturgy is, to what the sacraments are, to what the feasts and seasons of the liturgical year are, etc., etc.? What kind of understanding? Without the vibrant sacramental and prayer life, catechesis becomes lifeless intellectualism and moralism. On the other hand, unless the doctrinal basis for the sacraments is understood and a moral praxis actually flows from the liturgical life, the sacramental life itself becomes impoverished and soon turns into hollow ritualism. I don't have to explain that, babad na babad kayo dyan. Integration, ika na. Okay? And then on 153, I just want to bring this to our attention again. In the Philippine context, the place of liturgy as a source for catechesis is exceptionally important. Why? Because of the Filipinos' natural attraction to celebration and song, for fiestas and festivities. We still can take comfort in the fact that our liturgical assemblies on Sunday especially, but in many areas still in the Philippines, kahit yung mga weekday assemblies natin for liturgy, ibang-iba na sa larawang nakikita natin sa maraming bansa, sa Europa o sa Amerika. Kung sa Europa o sa Amerika, nagsasara ang ilang mga parokya, and two or three parishes are merged into one because there are fewer Catholics who celebrate na sila ng Sunday. Dito naman, I think we can boast of the fact still, no? We can still boast of the fact that our churches are bringing food. And so, indeed, no? Filipinos have natural attraction to celebration and song, yes, and festivities. And therefore, in our work of catechesis, liturgical education, we can really count on liturgy, a source of leading people to maturation in the faith. We still can count on the liturgy because we know our people love it, are fond of it, are so strongly attracted to it still, to the sacraments. This makes the liturgy a privileged means of effectively communicating the message. But there is a downside to that. Unfortunately, worship is often seen as only one dimension of life, without any particular connection with life, social, economic, and with life, social, economic, and political aspects. And so with that, I jump to NSCBP number 306, where it speaks of this time, sacramental catechesis proper. Given that, as a premise, the previous articles, what they say, no? What is the task, the particular task of liturgical sacramental catechesis? Okay, so 306 tells us, okay, a good liturgical sacramental catechesis can help Filipino Catholics understand what they're doing and what is really taking place in the liturgy. And as I said, first in our agenda has to be that. Make understood what really is the liturgy. What is really taking place in the liturgy? Because unless we understand what it is, what is supposed to be taking place there, we cannot lead our people, no matter what their age bracket is, to it. To assume the proper attitudes that should underlie their actions and gestures in the liturgy. The sentiments of gratitude, praise, even dependence on God, no? Repentance. And then third, strive to live according to what they believe and celebrate. So sacramental liturgical catechesis should help our people towards all of those. Under a certain understanding, attitude, and a way of life. And then it continues, the same article. So Through a solid and adequate liturgical sacramental formation, Filipino Catholics can be brought to a conscious and holistic Catholic worship, fruitful for their own personal faith life and for the life of their faith communities. And then, in 317, it almost prescribes an approach. An effective catechetical approach to the sacraments does go beyond merely giving factual information about the sacraments and concentrate on inspiring those being catechized to a personal appreciation of the importance of the sacraments for living out the Catholic faith. We should do more than giving information, but we need to form and to transform. It continues, catechesis must focus on explaining the reasons why receiving and celebrating the sacraments is essential for Filipino Catholics to be the disciples of Jesus Christ. I was so happy to see that phrase, especially when I saw the title of this year's meeting, 15th meeting of the AMCM, Educating the Disciples of Christ. Catechesis must focus on explaining the reasons why receiving, celebrating the sacraments is essential for Filipino Catholics to live as disciples of Jesus Christ and His community, the Church, now in today's Philippines. And then, from the Catechism for Filipino Catholics, we have in 1468, the Church's sacramental life has been radically revitalized as a result of the liturgical renewal set in motion by Vatican II. In other words, that tall order that our National Catechetical Directory gives us has been helped quite a great deal by the Vatican II liturgical renewal. Sa papaanong paraan, ginawang mas madali sa atin eh. Basta lang alam natin kung paano, ano yung prinsipyo, ano yung underlying foundation on which it stands. Ginawa talaga ng Vatican II. So, dyan po magsisimula ang aking sharing sa inyo. But again, I want to read that. The Church's sacramental liturgical life has been radically revitalized as a result of the liturgical renewal set in motion by Vatican II. We know that the Second Vatican Council's Constitution on Sacred Liturgy or Sacrosanctum Concilium is now almost 52 years old because it was promulgated on December 4, 1963. Kaya po nung December 4, 2013, it reached its 50th year. So magiging, 52 na ba? Okay. 2015, no? Okay. And it was the first among the 16 documents that came out of the council. And I would like to share how Sacrosanctum Concilium and the liturgical renewal that it set in motion helps us, no, in our ministry of catechesis, religious education, formation in the faith. And I would like to refer to it as having a pastoral vision, Sacrosanctum Concilium and the liturgical renewal that it advanced forward has a vision that is pastoral. But a pastoral vision that stands on a theological foundation. Pastoral vision, theological foundation. It is pastoral and practical in nature. And why not? If this is the vision that it has. Enshrined where? In SC 14. SC 14, Sacrosanctum Concilium number 14, which speaks of the active, full, and conscious participation of the faithful in liturgical celebrations. In other words, lahat ng ginawang reforma ng Second Vatican Council sa mga sakramento, sa pagdiriwang ng
pieces of the liturgical year.
Hello?
Wala na po siguro yung baterya.
Hello po. So lahat ng ginawang reforma, pagbabago ng Second Vatican Council on the way the sacraments are celebrated, on the way the feasts and seasons are celebrated, or the general calendar as a whole, no? No, the language that is used for celebrating the Mass and the other sacraments, lahat po na curriculum yan, as we know, ay para dito, the active, full, and conscious participation of the faithful in the liturgical celebrations. Here is how it is articulated. Mother Church earnestly desires that all the faithful should be led to that full, conscious, and active participation in liturgical celebrations, which is demanded by the very nature of the liturgy. Such participation by the Christian people as a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a redeemed people, is their right and duty by reason of their baptism. Bakit yan ang vision ng Second Vatican Council as far as the liturgy is concerned? First, because that is what is demanded by the very nature of the liturgy. That kind of participation is demanded by the very nature of the liturgy na ating pong maikling liliwan natin no, sa session natin ito. Pangalawa, okay, sino itong sabayan ng ito na nagliliwang ng liturgy? The liturgical assembly. Who are they? Sila lang naman yung chosen race, royal priesthood, holy nation, redeemed people, by virtue of their baptism. Pero alam niyo po, the constitution of the sacred liturgy does not begin with practical measures on how to realize the vision. Its vision is very practical and pastoral, the active, full, conscious participation of the people of God in liturgical celebrations, but it does not begin with practical measures on how to realize the vision. So, what articles come before SC 14? Of course, 1 to 13, di ba? Alam niyo po, ganyan, makakatulong sa atin, if we catechists, if we formators, no? Catechist formators, liturgical, religious educators, no? We have a good picture, no? Of the framework of Sacrosanctum Concilium. Focal point, we have SC 14. What was the vision of the council in reforming the liturgy? The full, active, and conscious participation of the people of God in liturgical celebrations. What comes before it? So, 2 to 13, bakit po po pinuwera yung number 1, SC 1? Because what we find in SC number 1 are just the four general goals of the entire council. They're not specific to liturgy. Kaya lang, why do we find them in SC 1? It's because Sacrosanctum Concilium was the first ever document to have been completed by the council. And that is why we find them there, that's right there. Okay? So, pag-ibasin nyo na lang po yung SC 1, kung ano yung apat na goals na yun, siguro mabilis ang sabihin ko na lang. First, intensification of the faith of Christians. Number two, the updating of the church, no? Okay, in terms of her ministering to the needs of the people of God. Ano yung pangatlo? Christian unity. Ano yung pangapat? And the religious dialogue. Of course, they are not exactly related that way, no? But I just paraphrase them. So that's all what you find in SC1. And then from 2 to 13, what do we have? Wow. It unfolds, it paints gradually the most, shall we say, solid theological foundation, theological treatment of what the liturgy is. At yan po aking malaking babahagi sa inyo in a while. At pagkatapos naman po ng 14, so 15 until the end of Sacrosanctum Concilium, they are the means to realize the vision. Makakatulong po kung malinaw sa atin yun. So, at the having a focal point, no, at the focal point is SC14, which is the vision itself. Full, active, conscious participation of the people of God in the liturgical celebrations. The articles that precede it build the foundation, the theological foundation on which it now stands. And all those that follow after SC14, they tell us how to realize that vision. Ilang pang numbers, ilang article numbers ng Sacrosanctum Concilium? Do you have any idea? 180. Okay. So the first 13 articles of Sacrosanctum Concilium unfold the most profound theological understanding of the liturgy that the church has ever conceived of in her 2,000-year history. How did the Council Fathers come up with that? How did they improve on previous articulations of the church for the theology of the liturgy? They did it by weaving together the revered treasures of the church in terms of sources. So this liturgy constitution does, by skillfully weaving together biblical, patristic, liturgical, and magisterial sources that form part of the revered literary treasure and tradition of the church. Kaya po, while you, I know you are very familiar with the idea that the catchword of the council was aggiornamento, updating. Okay? Yung iakma, ang pagkilos, paggawa, paglilingkod ng simbahan, ayon sa pangangailangan ng kasalukuyang panahon, aggiornamento, pukoyda, Pope, St. Pope John the 23rd, 1959, on the eve of the opening of the Second Vatican Council. Aggiornamento, yan ang nais gawin ng simbahan sa pamamagitan ng liturgical renewal that was enshrined in Sacrosanto Concilium, updating. Pero, baka po hindi alam ng marami sa atin, may isa pang catchword, this time it's not in Italian, it's in French, ressourcement. Meaning, the resource among going back to the sources. Going back to the sources. Okay? Okay, just to give an idea, SC 2 to 13 alone has 38 biblical citations from both the Old and the New Testament. It has 3 citations from patristic sources, 11 citations from ancient and recent liturgical texts, and 2 from magisterial sources. Pinag-uusapan po natin dito, the first 2 articles, 2 to 13 na ha. Of course, meron pang iba. Ngayon makikita, okay, if you read from 15 until the end of the document. Pinag-uusapan lang natin dito, no? 2 to 13. And we already find this many citation of sources. Bible, writings of the fathers of the church, ancient and recent liturgical texts, and of course, magisterial sources. Okay? Pinilisan ko po ito, okay? Itong mga few slides, no, na sa musunod, okay? Basta po ang nais ko lang dito, ma-impress, no, sa inyo, to impress upon you, okay? That indeed, SC 2 to 13, no, it has been woven together out of the church's revered sources. Okay? From both the Old and the New Testament, 2 to 3, has reference to 3 patristic liturgical texts. Sino sila? St. Ignatius of Antioch, St. Augustine. Bibilisan ko lang po ito. Pero kung mas gusto niyo po magpalalim dito, iiro ko naman po ito sa inyo. Okay? For some reasons, no, some of you might want to take a closer look at this. Okay? Also makes 11 references to liturgical texts, ancient sacramentaries, ancient ordinances, yung pong description ng pagdiriwang, no, ng panahon, okay? In Article 5, there are 4. Sacramentarium Veronense, yan. Yeah, define all of those. A preface of the Roman Missa, see? Okay? Okay? Also to consider documents, especially the decrees of the Council of Trent. Okay? In other words, I did my homework. Ano bang pinagsama-sama? In order that the Council will be able to articulate the profound theology of liturgy for all of us. So, ulit. The Liturgy Constitution skillfully weaves together biblical, patristic, liturgical, and magisterial sources that form part of the revered literary treasure and tradition of the Church. For what? To unfold the most profound theological understanding of the liturgy that the Church has ever conceived of in her 2,000-year history. Sutta. There is always a vision of the liturgy that is no longer just derived from philosophical deductions, but from the point of view of salvation history. Salvation history as it unfolds in the pages of sacred scripture. Salvation history as it was understood and taught by the fathers of the church. Salvation history as it has been enshrined in the venerable prayers of the church. Ganyang pag-unawa po ng liturgiya ang makikita natin sa pahina ng Sacrosanto Concilium. Not from philosophical deductions, but from the perspective of salvation history. At bakit nagawa niya yan? Dahil nga po sa tinignan niya, binusisi niya, binalikan niya ang mga mayayamang sources ng ating pananampalataya at pagsamba. And this is what we will be able to see, to find, in seeing together those revered sources. That we can almost equate liturgy with salvation history. But you see, I don't have a period yet. I have three dots. Because we have to qualify it. Liturgy is salvation history, yes. But salvation history, as it is celebrated and therefore made present, made available to us, made accessible to us, tangible to us, by means of rites and prayers. Liturgy is salvation history, celebrated, made present, made available, made accessible, by means of rites and prayers. In other words, the liturgy accomplishes today, here and now, the work of our redemption accomplished by Christ once and for all in history. May nagpa-check po sa akin ng item sa isang exam. Isang example niya, isang item niya doon ay the Eucharist. In the Eucharist, Christ's sacrifice on the cross is repeated. Hindi po pwede, yun, mali po yun. Okay, Christ offered His life, He died for our salvation once and for all. Anong nangyayari sa liturgiya? It is celebrated that once and for all sacrifice of the Lord on the cross, and celebrated, it is made present in another form. What form? In the form of word proclaimed, in the form of actions that are done, in the form of songs, etc., etc., ritual elements. But it is true, the liturgy accomplishes today, here and now, for the end, hic et nunc, the work of our redemption accomplished by Christ once and for all in history. You know why I enclose in quotation marks today and hic et nunc? Kasi po, lagi natin nakikita yan sa ating mga liturgical prayers. Diba? Pasko. Today is born our Savior Christ the Lord. Hodie, Christus natus est. Di po ba? Hic et nunc, here and now. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Hindi po natin mapapahindian yan. Di po ba? Okay, in short, bawat isa po sa atin, lalo na yung may kinalaman, involved, no? Sa gawain pagtuturo ng simbahan, they should have this conviction. Parang sa tingin ko po, hindi tayo pwede pagturo ng sakramento, ng mga feasts and seasons of the liturgical year, ng Eucharistia, kung wala sa atin ang conviction na ito. That in the liturgy, the work of redemption is accomplished. Or in other words, that in the liturgy, what Christ did for our redemption is being accomplished here and now. The catechist, the theology teacher, the religious educator, the formator, just has to be equipped with this. Or he or she will not be able to do justice to the rich liturgical sacramental doctrine of the church. I'm sorry. We just have to have this conviction that in the liturgy, what Christ did for our redemption is being accomplished here and now, today. Articles 2 and 7 of the Liturgy Constitution, Sacrosanctum Concilium, are particularly eloquent in expressing this theological description of the liturgy. Kaya po, malakas ang loob kong sabihin yung affirmations na yan. Kasi po, hindi naman galing sa akin, kundi po, ito'y galing sa conciliar document itself. And it says, in Sacrosanctum Concilium number 2, that in the liturgy, the work of our redemption is accomplished. That what Christ did for our redemption, on the cross especially, is made present, is recalled and made present in the liturgy. In other words, sumasap ngayon, sumasa dito, hindi lang po time dimension, pati place, space, no? Base space and the time dimension. Sa oras ng ating pagdiriwang, sumasa ngayon, sumasa dito, ang ating kaligtasan, ang ginampan ni Jesus para sa ating kaligtasan. Hindi inuulit, kundi isinasa ngayon, isinasa dito. Eh, bakit kailangan mangyari yun? Para mahawakan natin. So that it may become available to us. So that it may become accessible to us. And so how are we able to access it? Through the word proclaimed. In the liturgy of the word. Through things. Actions. The bread. The wine. So much so that when the priest has the body of Christ and we say Amen, we are actually saying that this is our faith conviction. Number 7, for its in its turn, says, the liturgy is an exercise of the priestly office of Jesus Christ by Christ himself and his body, the church. And what is the priestly office of Jesus Christ? Gawain ng pare, pangunahin mula nung umpisa ng simbahan ay ang mag-alay ng sakripisyo. Ang sinasabing priestly office of Jesus Christ, syempre po walang iba kundi yung nakikita natin. Pag-aalay ng sarili niya. Hindi siya nag-alay ng tupa, ng baka, o ano mga sinusunog na hain, kundi ang kanyang sarili. At anong sinasabi ng SC 7? The liturgy is an exercise of that priestly office of Christ. Alam niyo po ba yung salitang exercise dyan? At saka po yung sa SC 2, in the liturgy, the work of our redemption is accomplished. Iisang Latin verb po yung ginagamit. Opus redemptionis nostrae exercetur. The work of our redemption is accomplished. Exercise din po ang ginagamit na verb. And then here, exercitat, so, muneris Christi sacerdotalis. So, iisang salita pong ugat. Exercise. Ewan ko po bakit iniba pa yung translation, pero kailangan tulong po kung isipin natin yun, ano? Okay? Exercise. So, ang tanong ngayon, who exercises in the liturgy, therefore here and now, at the celebration of the liturgy, the priestly office of Christ? Who exercises the priestly office of Christ? It continues to be Christ. It continues to be Christ who exercises his priestly office. But this time, hindi po siya nag-iisa. Hindi po siya nag-iisa. The paragraph just before, where you find this in SC 7, tells us that in the liturgy, Christ always associates the church in his continuing work for our redemption. Ngayon, kasama na niya tayo. So who exercises the priestly office of Jesus Christ in the liturgy? Both Christ and the church. In other words, the whole body of Christ, head and members. Okay? So, makakulong po kung babasahin yung mag-isa din, no? Ang SC7. In short, in the liturgy, the church celebrates the presence of salvation today. Here and now, by means of ritual action. And what happens therefore is, with that, tingnan nyo, walang panahon which we can say is Christless or redemptionless. Mula nung si Kristo ialay niya ang kanyang buhay bilang sakripisyo para sa ating kaligtasan, wala na panahon na Christless or redemptionless until He comes again. Why? Because there is liturgy. That is what the liturgy does. The liturgy extends the work of Christ in time and space until He comes again. Sa tingin ko po, yan ang dahilan kung bakit nandito ako sa harapan niyo. Para kung siguro mahirap maintindihan bakit lay person, lay woman, no? Nagsasalita ko po sa liturgy, no? Kasi po nakita ko itong maganda at napakalalim na katotohanan ito. And I wanted no less. I wanted to be a servant of His greatness. Sa biyaya po ng Diyos, sana mapatuloy na may nagkakaroon pa ng pagkakataon na dito na may babahagi ito. Lalo na sa inyo po na by the multiplier effect, no? Mas marami pa ang mapapasahan ninyo na ganitong pangunawa. The celebration of the liturgy extends the work of Christ in time and space until He comes again. Okay? I'll try to articulate it some other way. The work of redemption accomplished by Christ continues today in the sacraments of the Church, in the celebrations of the feasts and seasons of the liturgical year, in the sanctification of time, in the liturgy of the hours. Alam niyo kung mas encompassing ngayon ang salitang liturgy. Okay, kung titingnan pa rin po natin, SC30 for example, isasama pa rin niya yung mga halagang devotion ng mga tao, no? Na hindi naman humilis sa tunay na spirito ng liturgiya. Isinasama din po niya yung panalangin privado, no? So, ang lawak po ng sako ng salitang liturgiya. Okay, pero ito pong nakasulat dito ang pangunahin. So, the work of redemption accomplished by Christ continues today in the sacraments of the Church, in the celebrations of the feasts and seasons of the liturgical year, and in the sanctification of time in the liturgy of the hours. In the liturgy, the salvation which Christ has already accomplished in His incarnation and paschal mystery is made available, is made accessible to all men and women, especially in the celebration of the sacraments, in and through the Church that came forth from the side of Christ as He slept the sleep of death upon the cross. Kailan niyo si Rembrandt? Okay? The painter, the Dutch painter, who painted the Prodigal Son. Natatandaan niyo po yung painting ng Prodigal Son na ginamit noong 1998 yata, Year of the Father, to highlight the mercy and compassion of the Father in preparation for the Great Jubilee of 2000, ito po yung ginamit nating tulong as kind of a visual aid, no? Yung the Prodigal Son. Pero, baka kala no, yan lang ang sikat at magandang obra maestra ni Rembrandt. Meron po po isa, yung Christ's deposition from the cross. Okay? Sinasabi po na ang kanyang pangunawa sa pamamagitan ng kanyang, well, simple faith, no? Okay? Having understood what we just had discussed so far, okay? He painted Christ being taken down from the cross. Pero isinama po niya ang sarili niya. Pero napansin niyo, attired not according to how the people during the time of Jesus dressed up, but according to the time of the 1600s, his own time. Yung pong pananampalataya niya na sumasa ngayon sa panahon natin, sumasa dito, ang hindi na mauulit pag pag-aalay sarili ni Jesus para sa ating kaligtasan. He tried to express that by means of His word as a painter. Christ's deposition on the cross. Isa pong dakilang papa, no? Unang papa na binigyan ng titulo The Great. Dalawa pa lang po so far, di ba? Si Leo the Great, tsaka si hindi po papa si Gregory the Great. Of course, naging maubog po yung discussion dati, no, na si Pope John Paul II, Saint Pope John Paul II, ay lalagyan din ang titulo The Great. Hindi ko po alam kung bakit nag-fade yun nang wala po sa usapan. Ano po? Pero ang unang papa na tinawag na The Great was Pope Leo the Great. Okay? And he was Pope in the middle of the 5th century. Isang celebration po, no, ng Ascension, no? The solemnity of the Ascension. He gave a homily. And he said, don't be afraid that the Lord has risen, has ascended to the Father. Because what in Christ was visible, passed on to the sacraments of the Church. What conspicuum erat in Cristo, transcribit in Ecclesiae Sacramenta. What in Christ was visible, passed on to the sacraments of the Church. Ang kanyang paghatawang tao, ang kanyang pagpapagaling, pagtuturo, pagpapakay ng maraming nagugutom, ang kanyang pag-aalay ng sarili sa krus, lahat ng iyan na tinapanan niya para sa kaligtasan, ang itinasa niya sa mga. Kaya sabi niya sa kanyang binibigyan ng homily, kayo ba ako? Huwag kayo magalala, huwag kayo mamamba. Bakit? Ang kanyang ginawa para sa ating kaligtasan ay kasama kami natin dahil ipinasa niya sa kanyang simbahan. Pero, ano ba si pagpasa? Nung ipinasa ba niya, then wala na siya dyan. Hindi ko po pag pinasa natin isang bagay sa isang tao, wala ka na dyan, siya naman ang nandyan, di ba? Siya naman ang may hawak. Pero kakaiba yung transcendent na pinag-uusapan nito. Ito, hayaan ninyo ang pagpaniwala sa atin ay ang SC7, Sacrosanctum Concilium number 7. That for the Church to accomplish so great a work, what work? Continuing Christ's work for our redemption, forgiving sins, teaching, preaching, etc., etc. To account for the Church to accomplish so great a work, Christ is always present in His Church, especially for liturgical celebrations. What a consolation. He is present in the sacrifice of the Mass, not only the person of His minister, the same now offering to the ministry of priests who formerly offered Himself on the cross, but especially under the Eucharistic species. By His power, He is present in the sacrament, so that when a man baptizes, it is really Christ Himself who baptizes. Consuelo de Bobo yan na galing sa akin, hindi po, Somosierra Concilium number 7. Kung may nagdududa po, kayo o ibang tao, pabasa niyo po ito. When a man baptizes, it is really Christ Himself who baptizes. For as the Church continues Christ's work of redemption, especially through the sacraments, Christ is always present. He is present in His words, since it is Himself who speaks when the Holy Scriptures are read in the Church. He is present lastly when the Church prays and sings, for He promised, where two or three are gathered together in My name, there am I in the midst of them. In other words, ang gusto ko pong sabihin, one cannot possibly understand the nature of the liturgy adequately, kahit sapat lang ang pinag-uusapan ha. One cannot possibly understand the nature of liturgy adequately without seeing its intimate relationship with the history in which Christ worked out, accomplished our reconciliation with the Father, in which He exercises priestly office, in short, salvation history. It's not possible. So, sa atin ito, if we think of liturgy this way, pwede po kayong mag-substitute the liturgy, the sacraments, the feasts and seasons of the liturgical year. The liturgy engrafts the faithful today, the feast of the moment of the celebration, into that uninterrupted flow of life and salvation that has been taking place in history. Ganyan po ang ginagawa ng mga sakramento. Ganyan pong ginagawa ng ating feasts and seasons of the liturgical year. Bakit ito ulit-ulit natin, taong-taong na lang? Sino tayo nagsawa? Ano mong conviction natin tungkol sa mga feasts and seasons na yan? Ang mga sakramento, bakit pa ulit-ulit tayo nagdiri- anfitriyon ng Eucharistia. Paulit-ulit tayong namumumpisan. Dapat hindi tayo mapayag hanggang kaya na hindi malanyaan ang isa nating kapamilya, kaibigan, mahal sa atin na nasa mabigat na karamdaman. Nais natin mapagkaloban sila ng sakramento because we are convinced, because we believe that the liturgy engrafts the faithful today. In the case of the moment of the celebration, into that uninterrupted flow of light and salvation that has been taking place in history. From the Old Testament, the promise, the foreshadowing, in its fulfillment, in the Gospel, in the person and life of Christ, and now, it continues through the sacraments of the Church. I tried to translate it. Hindi po ba ganito ang mga sakramento? Hindi po ba ganito ang mga fiesta at pagdiriyo ng simbahan? Itinutugtong tayo ng liturhiya sa patuloy at walang patid na daloy ng buhay at pagliligtas. No interruption, walang patid na daloy ng buhay at pagliligtas. Why? Because that history, that salvation is made available and accessible.